Good evening. I'm Stephanie Barron. I'm Senior Curator of Modern Art at the Museum, and I am delighted to welcome you to this evening's program, A Conversation with Virginia Dwan, on the occasion of the opening of the exhibition, Los Angeles to New York, Dwan Gallery, 1959 to 1971. I should say also that there's a related two-hour free film program that'll be presented here in the Bing Theater this Saturday at 1 o'clock, including rare films from the 1960s and 70s by Robert Breer, Yves Klein, Stan Vanderbeek, Robert Smithson, and Nancy Holt, all related to activities of the Dwan Gallery artists. And I hope you all make plans to attend. This exhibition examines the history of the remarkable gallery, which 28-year-old Virginia Dwan opened in a storefront in Westwood in 1959, where she presented groundbreaking shows of New York artists, as well as LA-based Ed Kienholz. In 1962, she moved to a second, purposely designed space in Westwood, which would remain open until 1967, and where she would show ambitious installations and monumental sculpture. In 1965, Dwan opened a gallery in New York on 57th Street, which she ran until 1971. During these intense 11-plus years, Dwan Gallery would come to present an astonishing range of artists in 134 exhibitions: abstract expressionism, pop art, French Nouveau Realism, minimal art, conceptualism, and moving beyond the gallery walls, earthworks. Dwan was a pivotal figure in the Los Angeles art world, often providing artists with stipends, studio space, and housing. At the time, the exhibitions presented at Dwan Gallery were at the forefront of post-war avant-garde art. She organized one of the first pop art exhibitions in the United States in 1962, and she was one of the earliest and most ardent supporters of minimal art and earthworks. Despite having made an indelible impression on the art world of the 1960s, Dwan and her gallery have received relatively little attention in art historical scholarship. Happily, that is now being corrected. This exhibition, which we opened this week, has been organized by James Meyer, Curator of Modern Art at the National Gallery of Art, in honor of the generous gift and promised gifts of 250 works from Dwan's personal collection to the National Gallery. We are delighted that James is here with us today and thank him for the comprehensive catalog that accompanies the show. James was assisted throughout the project by Paige Rosansky, curatorial assistant at the National Gallery of Art, whose contributions to the catalog is invaluable. Any research, project, question, or conversation about the Dwan Gallery is always aided with tremendous grace and thoroughness by Ann Kovac, curator of the Dwan Collection and Dwan Archive. And Anne, we are all in your debt. Thank you so much. And you should be able to tell that unfortunately Michael Govan, who was to have joined us in this conversation, is en route, and he's, as he said, a little south of Heiser City and a little north of Spiral Jetty. As he is making his way west, he was a casualty of the blizzard in New York. So he will get here at some point this evening. For additional background on Virginia Dwan and Dwan Gallery, I really encourage you to look at the 20-minute documentary film that was made by the National Gallery, which is viewable in our small theater in the exhibition. This is definitely a season for publications related to Dwan. In addition to the catalog, Virginia Dwan and Dwan Gallery, edited by Germano Tulant and published by Skira, includes a fascinating chronology by Chiara Costa together with Ann Kovac. The recent publication of photographs by Virginia Dwan called Flowers, published by Radius Books, and a forthcoming compendium of essays about artists of Dwan Gallery to be published this fall by MIT Press. Michael's giving us an update of where he is. This week, it is indeed a rare opportunity for us to welcome Virginia Dwan back to Los Angeles, 58 years after she opened that storefront gallery in Westwood. Personally, I must say how much of an honor it is to have you here, Virginia. The impact of your gallery and your commitment to artists is legendary, and this exhibition and publication offer a long overdue opportunity to understand your adventurous program and to put into context your gallery activities. So let's get started. James, would you like to start it off?
Yes, I would. And thank you so much for that gracious introduction. And I must tell everyone how thrilled I am that the show is here at LACMA. It means so much to me and to all of us at the National Gallery that Virginia's story, which is a Los Angeles story, which begins here, could be brought back to LA. And I'm particularly grateful to Stephanie for bringing the show here. You've done a beautiful job installing it. And you've brought sort of other aspects to the material that I was unable to feature in Washington, which we might talk about as we move forward. So thank you very much. And also Katja Zavistovsky, the assistant curator in the department, worked very carefully on this show as well. So thank you to you and LACMA for doing this.
Thank you. All right, so let's begin. Do you want to kick it off?
Well, Virginia, so here we are in Los Angeles, where it all began, and here we are looking at your storefront gallery on Broxton Avenue in Westwood, and the show that you did about 15 artists from New York, one of your first shows in 59 and 60 when you opened the gallery. And question that always I think is important to ask, you've been asked it, but I think it's important to think about geography and to ask why Westwood. Would you mind telling us a little bit about that, why Westwood?
And not La Cienega Boulevard.
Yes.
Well, actually, my ex-husband was going to UCLA Medical School, and Westwood was close by, so it was serendipitous. There was a space there, yeah.
But wasn't there this dream that you would be surrounded by all the patrons in Beverly Hills?
Beverly Hills, Holme Hills. Surely there'd be collectors there somewhere to come and see what I was doing. You know.
And they all flocked. And what was the collecting scene like in Los Angeles then?
Well, it wasn't really great. You know? You have a list of 12 collectors. I thought there were fewer. I thought it was 10.
Right, I think we're jumping ahead a couple of slides, but
okay.
All right. So I thought we'll kind of work up to that a little bit, but we're kind of going to begin with actually some works from the late 50s, Kanemitsu and Robert Goodnow, and it was actually nice, if you can see the credit line, this was actually a very early gift to LACMA from Virginia. So we kind of begin the exhibition with two artists, and I wonder, then we move on to really kind of one of the first very important exhibitions, the Franz Klein and Philip Guston, and we can see an installation view in the center, and then Klein on the left and Guston on the right.
Right, and so there's this leap. I think there was about a year of shows where you weren't quite clear about what was happening and totally focused. And then suddenly you're showing this major abstract expressionist work. I'm curious how that happened. How did you make that leap to Guston and Klein after about a year and a half?
Oh, quite honestly, I don't know how that happened. Actually, I wanted to open the gallery doors, and so I had a few shows that I wasn't terribly devoted to, but the doors were open and we were ready to go. My sister-in-law, who was working with me, would travel. I would go and then she would go to New York, and in that way, we got to know quite a few of the artists very quickly, actually, introduced by other artists.
I mean, you made these field trips, if you will, these research trips, and it was just one of the arguments of the show, and you'll read this in the catalog, is that the jet airplane is coming into major use for commercial travel of passengers in 59, connecting the two coasts, and so that's making partly this possible, this movement back and forth between the coasts that you're involved in, and you're doing this research.
Yeah, and I don't know if anybody remembers that or if I've made it up in my own mind, but actually, I think that we used to take 3.5 hours to go between the coasts because the planes were carrying more fuel and they were going faster at that time, and then they cut back after that, and now it's something like 5 hours, which is so different, yeah, but it was really good.
It was a revolution.
Yeah,
it was a revolution.
Yeah, sure, definitely.
And so you'd go and do research, and you, I believe that Larry Rivers was important, who was in that show of the different artists, of New York artists, in terms of meeting people like de Kooning and so on.
He introduced me to so many people. Certainly de Kooning, but also people like Giacometti and Terry Southern, and I can't think who all else, but he was very open about doing that and very helpful to me, yeah.
And the Philip Guston and Franz Klein show that's so wonderful and marked by these two works that you exhibited in the show itself here. I seem to recall you wanted to do a whole show of Franz Klein and a whole show of Guston, but there was not enough work.
That's right.
How did you get the work? I mean, did you contact the dealers? How does one get the stuff to LA?
Somehow you made a phone call, I guess. That doesn't happen anymore. But he made a phone call and said, I would like to see your studio and your work. And I got to know Philip Guston particularly well, but I told him that I wanted to do a show of him and Franz Klein, who was also a friend of his, and I just barely knew at that time. So we went to his studio first and picked out the works for LA, and then went over on 14th Street to Franz Klein's studio and knocked on the door, and it was opened by a woman with a kettle on her head. And that was Betsy Zogbaum, the sculptor, but she and Franz were dating or living together at that time, and Franz had gone out for cigarettes, and Betsy was left with thinking that she was opening the door to him, but to us.
Surprise.
Instead. And I saw some of, I think, actually, they were the first of Franz Klein's colored works at that time, as well as his black and white were, all of them, so wonderful.
So your exhibition was black and white and colored works? Or only?
Yeah.
Both. And you installed them, if I recall, kind of opposite each other?
I don't remember. Maybe they were.
Well, we have a shot of that.
Yeah, they are
opposite.
Yeah.
Were they opposite each other, though?
Yeah, the Gustins are on the right and the Kleins on the left.
Right.
And then you were able to give Klein his own one-person show, but it was a memorial show, right? He had passed away.
It was a memorial show, actually, almost the minute that we got word that he had died. I was very, very moved. I didn't know him very well, but somehow he had tremendous impact on me. And so we got together that show, John Weber and myself, and he contacted people who had Franz Klein paintings because I didn't have enough to make a whole show, and borrowed things here in Los Angeles.
I love that the painting you were able to include, Stephanie Torres, was in both of the Klein shows.
Right.
So it's very special.
No, and that's nice because that has such a wonderful LA history. It was owned by B and Phil Gersh, kind of early patrons of the gallery, and now owned by David and Susie Gersh. So it's kind of nice to have
it's a treasure. Kind
of, yes, exactly. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about Larry Rivers and the importance that he had for you in terms of also kind of an entree to other artists.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, and there's, can we go back? So I love that he dedicates this to my great dealer and her son in Surf. Yeah. And in his autobiography, I recall that he just talks about driving out all the way across the interstate highway with Clarice Price.
Yeah.
And landing in Malibu at your house on the beach there. Right, right. And that you put people up. You had a guest house.
You had a guest house.
And people would stay, right? It was.
Yes, exactly. We had sort of ramshackled little house in the back where people would stay. They were. Artists were not expecting very much in those days, actually. Yeah. Things were much simpler looking.
And you would also give artists studios to work in, right? Would you rent a studio?
Later we had a studio, which was an ex-factory of some sort, and Jean Tinglin and Nikki Sanfal worked in that space. Mm-hmm. And do you think there was there were others? I think just them.
With the factory space.
I'm not sure.
Here we have Rauschenberg, and we're looking at the wooden gallop on the right, and wasn't that...
I don't think that Rauschenberg made pieces.
Because I thought that I thought that part of the material there was from L.A., from the beach.
Yeah, I think some of those materials were from your beach at Malibu.
Well, thank you for informing me. There are certain things I don't quite remember.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's interesting because so many of the combines in that incredible show of yours, of Rauschenberg, were New York works that were shipped all the way from New York. But
most
I do believe,
and it's kind of interesting. In the exhibition, we have the inventory book from the gallery, and it was really fascinating to kind of go through page by page. But what we chose to open it to was one of the pages from the Rauschenberg combine show, and if you look. You know, they're the inventory of the objects and where they came from, and then there's that whole column of, you know, sold to, and it's blank. I think I'm correct that none of the combines sold. And then you returned them to New York?
No, that's kind of an interesting story, at least to me. But we had a work called First Landing Jump, and it was had a tire and something... painting above it. It was rather large work, and at that time, I remember that it was priced at $8,500. And we kept it after the Rauschenberg show, thinking somebody was going to buy it. Yeah, and John Weber sent it around in Texas to various collectors there, and finally nobody bit, and so it was time we had to send it back to Leo Castelli, who had given it on, sent it on consignment. And Leo, as the story goes, called in Philip Johnson, and Philip Johnson bought it on the spot and gave it to the Museum of Modern Art, to MoMA. So I sort of felt, when I see that painting at MoMA, I think, those collectors in Los Angeles and Texas didn't get this great piece, because it really was a very special
That page work. In your inventory book made me very sad.
Yeah.
But, one thing I like about your attitude about selling at the time, you've been quoted in saying that you wanted to sell in part to get the stuff into people's homes so they could live with it and experience it. It wasn't about, for you, making a lot of money, and there wasn't a lot of money to be made. It was about getting the work out there.
I wanted to sell the work because I felt that people would appreciate it more if they bought it rather than just receiving it. And also so that they might actually spend time looking at the work for some period of time and appreciating the work, actually. And that was my motivation in these,
I thought we'd maybe turn to Yves Klein, series of beautiful shows, and he spent time in Los Angeles. And so I thought maybe looking at the monochrome exhibition from 1961, and Then there he is working in Malibu. And just thought, talk a little bit about his time in Los Angeles.
Yes. Yves Klein has gotten a rather bad reputation in the past of just taking nudes and scrubbing them around on paper or canvas. And that's really mostly what people know about Yves. But he was a very fascinating personality, and my ex and myself got to know him quite well, and in the south of France as well. And he had amazing ideas of things that he was hoping to do, yet he wanted to have build architecture from jets of air coming out of the ground that would not allow any weather or birds or whatever come into this space. The jets themselves would be the walls. And he also described beds that he thought should be made for hospitals. And the beds were to be jets of air, that so the person lay on jets of air, and that way they didn't get what is it called?
Bed sores?
Bed sores, exactly. And also, they wouldn't have the beds to worry, concern themselves with, I guess. You just turn on the jet of air. He was involved with the whole universe, actually, and very important to my thinking. The blue, the monochrome blue that he did was an expression of the sky, of the emptiness and the bigness of our sky. And he thought in worldly and even cosmic terms. So he was far more interesting than most people realize.
And when he came to LA and you showed the film of the anthropometries being made, those body prints, I seem to recall that the reaction was not necessarily positive among the LA artists. There was a certain...
Well, actually, some of them were nicely impressed.
All right.
And then John L. Toon was really the only person that got up during a filming of what you're talking about, of the Yves film that he brought with him, and stormed out of the gallery and said a few well-chosen four-letter words. And that was the end of that. But actually, nobody else left.
Oh, right. So it was really, okay.
Yeah, they were.
But let me ask you, so did you see your mission? You're going all the way to New York, and then you're going to Paris during the summers, and you're bringing this art to LA. Did you see part of your mission to bring this work to artists in LA? Was that because you were always friends with artists, even before you opened your gallery.
That's right.
Was that part of your concern, was to...
Well, I wasn't really specifically concerned about the artist seeing it necessarily. I just wanted everyone to see it, and collectors and artists and just people interested. I felt that I had these wonderful riches that I wanted to spread around, for other people to enjoy also. And one of the reasons for having a gallery, to me it seemed, was that you could sit with the work for one whole month. One whole month you're sitting there looking at these works and really getting to know the art and the artist that way.
I wanted to talk a little bit about Klein and the relationship to LA collectors, because clearly one of the collectors, Michael and Dorothy Blankfurt, kind of took a kind of a leap of faith to be engaged with the project in Paris. So we have some nice photographs of the transfer. And I wondered if you could kind of describe that event.
Well, first of all, Michael and Dorothy were beautiful people. I liked them very much. But, of course, they shared my taste in art, too, so that makes it easier. Somehow I got word that they were in Paris when I was there, and Yves Klein had something called an immaterial. There's a longer title, but I don't remember it all, but at any rate, it involved a receipt for a certain amount of gold bullion, or gold leaves even, and he signed the receipt and gave it to the collector.
You can see
right?
The second slide there is actually signing the receipt.
Yeah, and in the meantime, he had gone to a bank and got some gold pieces about that big, and they were thrown into the Seine. And that was the immaterial itself. Knowing it was art that then disappeared, that was ephemeral. And I was standing by watching, not in the photographs for some reason, but I was seeing bombs lying along the Seine on the embankment, sleeping. And little did they know that gold was being thrown into the water right where they were. Exactly. And that was a wedding gift that the Blankfords gave to their daughter, who is here tonight. And I thought it was a beautiful sort of gift for a wedding. Thank you.
Yeah, very nice. So, kind of coming back to James's question, I was struck by a piece of paper I found in your archive, which is dated 1965, and it says Dwan Gallery Collectors, and it fits on about a half a piece of paper. There are 12 names, including the Pasadena Art Museum, and I thought it might be interesting for this audience to kind of walk through it a little bit. So I have some images. So we have kind of on the first on the right, we have Fred and Marcia Wiseman, we see in the Hockney picture. Walter Hobbs from the time at the Pasadena Art Museum. Ed Jans, Betty Asher, Michael and Dorothy Blankford, B and Phil Gersh, Polly and Mel Hirsch. It's a small list. So when you talk about it being kind of a hard to kind of get work to be sold, I mean this was a core group of people who kind of kept frequenting the gallery and were clients.
Well, there had been some contemporary art much too early to get a response at that point. But finally, at the point where I was in time, there were really basically two of us. There was Irving Blum, who's here tonight, I believe, and Ferris Gallery, and my gallery, Dwan Gallery. And so you can imagine that 12 collectors, and we had a show each of 12 months times two. You know, there weren't enough collectors to go around. It just wouldn't work. And part of the reason I moved to New York, and just part of it. Yeah.
So next, you opened the second space in Westwood. This time, it really was a space that you designed. You participated in the design of it. And I kind of like how you described the feeling that you wanted the visitors to have as they walked into the space. Could you kind of explain that a little bit, the tunnel kind of effect of
Oh, well, I hope that people coming through what was sort of a tunnel actually into the gallery were, in sci-fi, they talk about going into the room where all your bad stuff is washed away, and I think that was sort of the idea that I had of the tunnel, that people would leave the world as we know it behind and come to be with the art, really be with it. Yeah.
And so if we look at the two Reinhardt shows in kind of the two different spaces, you can kind of really get a sense of how much space you had, and also how you designed the gallery so that there was a this something to protect the work so that people didn't get too close to them, but I think also kind of help with the light and kind of help with the spirit of the picture. The
yeah,
place.
Actually, working with the architect, I had had a show already of Anne Reinhardt, and there were nine foot paintings mostly in that group in the old gallery. So the ceilings were higher there. So I wanted to make sure that the architect would design a space that could allow me to show more of the Ad Reinhardt's or anybody else's work that was over 9 feet. And so I had him put marble on the floor to keep us from getting too close to the works. However, then Ad showed up with his little medicine bag and everything at the airport, and the paintings were sent to me, and they turned out to be 5 by 5 foot paintings, not 9 foot. So my plans for the show were quite different, finally.
All right, so then we have Armand, who came to Los Angeles, mm-hmm. And we have this fantastic work of the alarm clocks. So these were clocks that were shipped from Europe?
Most of them were shipped from Europe, but he did certain ones in the basement of the gallery. And so I would hear Kiai suddenly coming across, you know, because he either hit the piece, whatever it was, with his feet or with his arm, you know, to break up a violin or a bass violin, or I guess it was mainly those two items. And he would come upstairs then and see myself and look triumphant that he'd killed something downstairs, yeah. But actually, the clocks were an important piece, but when I first saw his work in Nice, what struck me, and took me a while to sort of feel what he was doing, but what struck me was that he was doing so many accumulations, as he called them, of eyeglasses and old teapots and shoe forms and so forth, which the Nazis had accumulated. And that, in fact, his work very much reminded me of the Holocaust and the remnants that were left behind. And so I found it very moving on that basis. Then he went on to work in polyurethane, and I couldn't understand those quite as easily. They were more art about art, whereas this was art about something that had happened in history that was quite horrible and that he really mm-hmm. developed.
Mm-hmm. So moving to others of the French New Realists, Marcel Reiss, who also you featured. We have two small works in the exhibition. So, and then Jean Tinguely and Nikki de Saint-Phalle. And I think you have two terrific pieces in the exhibition, which we have a nice little video so that you can kind of see them moving. But I thought you had some nice stories to tell about.
Well, Yves introduced me to Armand, and then Armand or Yves introduced me to Marcel Reyes, and then I knew Tingley through New York and his exhibitions there, and Tingley introduced me to Nikki St. Paul. That's the way it went, anyway. And it was very, very exciting to see new work there, which was not what we think of as European art. And it was not abstract art, it was something else they were doing. And I've never seen it as actually pop art. I think that's an American phenomenon. But they had their own thing happening, and which they called New Realists. And I found it quite interesting, actually, and enjoyed having them there. All four of those artists came to Los Angeles. In fact, as we're going through some of this, I realize how many artists did come to Los Angeles, yeah. Really.
And there's a nice photo there on the lower right of a gathering in Malibu with several of the artists. I mean, we have Merce Cunningham, Louise Nevelson, Philip Guston, Jules Langsner. I mean, it was a nice gathering at your beach house.
Yeah, I was very fortunate to know these people really quite well. And I think, well, it goes back even further. It goes back to Paul Brock and Miriam Shapiro came to our house in Los Angeles, but then, for instance, Rauschenberg came, all the new realists came, and from then on, even when I went to New York, finally, and John Wepper was staying with the gallery here, Saul LeWitt came, and Carl Andre came, and there were a lot of people here.
And I think, and Oldenburg came? Nice photograph,
and
a great photograph
of...
his
wife, Patty, were... actually, they lived in Venice, which was very appropriate at the time, in a sort of motel, and it made good sense.
some nice Oldenburg works, and then there was the performance, the Autobodies performance, which took place up on Beverly Boulevard, and we actually are screening in the exhibition on a loop the Autobodies film. So,
yeah, I wonder if there is anyone here that remembers that. Maybe Tony Berlant might remember it. Yeah,
that's nice. So can all have a chance to see that film in the show. All right, I know we want to kind of get, we have a lot more to get through, but John Wepper was running the gallery.
He took over the gallery, still my gallery, but he was the director and was alone here at the gallery while I was in New York. So that's between 55 and 57.
65 and 67, yeah.
67.
Yeah.
65 and 67.
And I think the boxes show, he was kind of,
he was the one that had the idea. Yeah. He developed it. He put together the artists and the announcement, which became quite famous, actually.
Yeah. There's some nice letters in the exhibition of people asking even for that catalog.
That was really John's doing. Yeah.
Also kind of noticed just how beautiful all the graphics were that you had in your announcements, your catalogs, all just, I think, greatly distinguished in terms of gallery, in terms of graphic design. So kind of feature some of those in the exhibition. Here's the boxes show as we've kind of tried to reconstitute it here. I wanted to ask if we talk a little bit about, I mean, Walter Hopps wrote the text for the Boxes catalog. Mm-hmm. And Pasadena Art Museum was certainly one of your kind of 12, your small group of collectors. And I wondered if you talk a little bit about the relationship with Hopps.
Well, Walter was quite a brilliant person, but I don't think he was cut out to be a day-by-day person that he had to be in his various lines of work. He would bring people to the gallery and discuss what the art was about. And he was very adept with words at talking about it. I have a real distaste of talking about art. Here I am. But this thing of that's a positive moving through this negative form. No, not for me. I like the gestalt of the work. I like to see what it's about, the thing complete. And anyway, that's it.
And of course, he did that incredibly important Duchamp retrospective at Pasadena, Duchamp's
right.
first retrospective.
Yeah.
And so the Boîte en Valise, the box with all of Duchamp's works, which Stephanie has rightly included and was in your boxes show, is in a way the totem for the whole show. It's Duchamp sort of brings the box in, or one of the people who introduces the box. So there's a Duchampian context in John Weber's interest in doing a boxes show, and Hopps is sort of part of it.
Right. Well, actually, I had bought the Boîte en Valise previous to that, and it did make sense to have it as part of one of the boxes mm-hmm. in the exhibition. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, all right. So I wanted to kind of get to Kienholz. You know, Backseat Dodge. It's nice to have it back. Being shown at LACMA, and I learned something about, I mean, we've had that piece in the collection now for quite some time. It was very famous at LACMA in 1966, but it made its first appearance at Dwan Gallery. And it's this kind of truncated car. And why is it truncated?
It's truncated. Well, he told me it wasn't going to go through the back door or the front door. So I said, well, cut it down then.
So I finally learned why it's the size that it is. So much for art history. Mm.
But what happened beyond that was that we were shut down too. We were closed and by the police. And we had given a cocktail party to Tom Bradley. At that time, he was running for the House of Representatives. I don't know. Locally, he was running for a smaller office at that point. And so we invited him and his friends and so forth to enjoy the gallery. And so John Weber called Tom saying, we've just been shut because something the police decided wasn't proper art. And he got it open within 24 hours. So I was so glad that we had that cocktail party before then.
And then it would make its appearance at LACMA and cause a similar kind of disturbance.
Right, very much
exactly.
So, yeah.
And there it is in the exhibition.
And then, of course, he went on to be mayor, so I was quite proud of that situation.
We have a nice group of Kienholz is in the exhibition. And then Kienholz becomes the artist with whom you open the gallery in New York, mm-hmm. which I mean, he's really the only California artist that you show in New York, and yet you made this commitment to show, and you opened it with your tablet.
With Kienholz. Well, I have to admit that I knew that that would... be noticed. A keynote exhibition of Barney's Beanery would certainly get some notice. But I didn't really quite expect what happened, because not only did all the magazines come, when I say all the major magazines, but the art magazines, but also things like Life and Look and Time and so forth. And they all wanted Barney's Beanery to be opened up so that you could open it out, so that they could photograph it. And I keep saying, well, we have photographs, really nice photographs. Yeah. And they say, oh no, they want to open and do their own photographing. So anyway, it was a wonderful piece to have there. And oh, and all the dealers, not all, Leo Castelli and Frank Lloyd from Marlborough and so forth came to the opening too. They were, I think everybody was curious who this girl was that was coming, because I was a girl then, coming from Los Angeles and opening a gallery in New York. Who was that?
In the middle of our exhibition, we have this really stunning kind of bright yellow Bob Grosvenor piece. And it's nice that it's kind of come back to Los Angeles. It was shown first at your gallery, and then a year later here at LACMA in Maurice Tuckman's American Sculpture of the 60s, and has been recently remade with the artist's cooperation. And it's nice to see it in your gallery and then up in our galleries as well.
Yes, it was a fabulous piece. We had to somehow screw it to the ceiling. I don't remember how we did that, but anyway.
Well, I can tell you that our art handlers wanted to know how you did it.
Yeah, you had to do it.
Because it was the largest crate that ever came into the museum. It was not an easy piece to make look so effortless in the gallery, so we're really thrilled, thrilled to be able to have it.
We also had the Suvaro show, and that was too tall for the gallery, so we took out part of the ceiling so that the piece could go up through the ceiling rather than not show it.
Fantastic. All right.
Well, one of the sort of narratives that the show traces, there's a narrative of different sorts of movements or styles. But there's also a narrative of what happens to the aesthetic object, to the work of art as a thing.
Yes.
And we start off with very advanced, but nevertheless conventional paintings and sculptures. Mm. And we move into installations, Kienholz's installations. And a work like that, Grosvenor, I mean, is just completely transforming what a work can be. What is an aesthetic object? Mm. And your gallery was this kind of reception point for very new kinds of aesthetic forms, literally. Mm-hmm. And I think mm-hmm. this just taking up a whole space, or the minimal work that we're going to look at, just changed what a work of art could be, how it could be experienced physically and bodily. Mm. That must have been very exciting.
That's a really good progression that you're pointing out. Because then you'll end up with land art also, mm-hmm. which is out on the land where a lot of people can't get to it, and
which abandons the gallery altogether.
Yeah.
But works like that, Grosvenor and the De Suvaro you're talking about, they're tugging at the walls and ceilings and expanding what a gallery can contain and present. The one thing to point out, of course, about the Beanery, the Kienholz, is you arrive in New York with his work, but you didn't have. It's important to stress, Virginia did not have a group of artists when she goes to New York. You had to build a whole new program.
Right.
Because so many of the people you'd been showing in LA had New York dealers already. And so you had to just invent a whole new program in New York.
Well, I became friends with Saul LeWitt, and he showed in the gallery, in my gallery, and then again out here afterward. And he introduced me to a lot of people, but I think the word got around in the art world that this woman was going to show things which were minimal, let's say, because we don't know another word for it, and very simple in forms. And so artists started showing up and showing me their work, and it was like they'd found a place, the right place for them, yeah, and it just grew from there. It was wonderful the way it was almost spiritual in some sense, that thinking was in the air, you know, and people were picking up on it.
So for 2 years, though, you juggled a New York gallery and an LA gallery. So for 2 years. So to look at, for instance, the 10 exhibition that you had in New York and LA, how did you kind of decide what would be where, or how did you split that up?
I couldn't keep track of everything. I mean, really, it didn't make sense. I'd be wanting to sell something and realize that actually it was in Los Angeles or it was in storage or something. So I wanted to consolidate everything in one place, and that was New York because that's where I was getting the most response.
Because it's totally a given now that most important galleries do have galleries in L.A. and New York and elsewhere, and you're kind of doing it for the first time. I mean, it was...
Well, no, actually, other people were...
Who was doing that?
Marlboro was doing that.
They had an L.A. space?
I think particularly Marlboro. And there were two people that came to work for me through the years that had worked at Marlboro, just moving cards, little, you know, recipe cards that we used to use with the name of the art and so forth, you know, in detail, moving them from one thing to another drawer, you know, because they'd gone to another place. And that was their job. That was what they had to do.
This is new. It's really new. To think, I mean, now it's just a given. We have computers with files.
I don't know how they do it at all.
But you're developing something different, and you're saying Marlboro, having outposts in these different coasts and moving things back. That's really interesting in terms of thinking about the history of dealing of art gallery.
But did you also think about what you could show in the different kinds of spaces? I mean, the space in L.A. was really quite different from your 57th Street.
No. Actually, I didn't. I really wanted to introduce L.A. to New York, I guess. And so maybe something...
But there was a scale of works that you could show.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Oh, of course. I thought you meant style or whatever. Yes, my gallery in New York was... maybe half or less than half the size of the one here. So I was sending shows out to John Weber. The Carl Andre show, Cuts, was really remarkable. Mm-hmm. And a show of Saul Lewitz, of all the variations that he did of big and small squares.
So should we talk a little bit about the language shows?
Well, for sure. So there, of course, Stephanie has wonderfully given a space to the conceptual work that Virginia showed. And of course, there were four shows that were called Language, and they were every summer. Mm-hmm. And so you turned the summer group show, which is typically just a hodgepodge of stuff left over from the season, into an idea, and the idea was conceptual or language art. Mm. And so did you come up with that idea yourself? Was Smithson involved, Weber? How did the language shows come about?
This is language two.
I remember talking to John about the language shows, and I liked the idea, but what I was involved in was, what appealed to me was the idea of words as objects. As objects, art objects. Then it became something else. words as descriptions of art objects, which was not what I wanted in the first place, but that's somehow what it grew into. And it was more conceptual, of course. It wasn't just language as such. It was the concept behind these, which was very different.
So moving after, really works then began to, you began to be engaged with artists who were moving to projects that came outside of the gallery, that really moved out into the land, out into nature. And I think that is, in a certain respect, an aspect for which you are most known in terms of your commitment to these artists, kind of foundational support. And here we've got a series of proposals for the Dallas-Fort Worth airport. And then a series of...
Robert Smithson was engaged to do that project, which was to include several other artists, including Saul LeWitt, who finally did bury a cube, which is what he intended to do there, and Carl Andre, and am I forgetting
Morris,
somebody?
Robert Morris.
Oh, Morris, okay.
So several of your artists, Morris, Carl Andre, LeWitt, were kind of brought into this.
Well, actually, Morris was a Lou Castelli artist, but I mean, I had shown Morris, but, anyway, that he brought him into it. Yes.
All right. So we've got, why don't we move to Smithson? Exactly. So your commitment to Smithson is really significant. So the Pine Barrens piece, do you want to talk a little bit about?
Non-sites you're referring
to?
Oh, yeah. That's a picture of, I think, Nancy Holt and maybe myself and, couldn't be, somebody.
Yeah.
Bob Smithson and Nancy Holt and Mary Peacock, who was friend of
and
Saul's.
And I think LeWitt took the picture. I think Saul was on that.
He should be.
Yeah.
He must be.
Yeah.
Anyway, Nancy and Bob and a group of other people as well, it turned out, had been looking for land for about 6 months maybe. And it turned out to do artwork on the land. And it turned out that everything that Nancy checked was already spoken for. Either the government owned it or it was private property. And so Bob Smithson got the idea, and I think that was related, but I've read things to the effect that he thought of it already before then. But at any rate, he did non-sites, which were metal bins. In this case, it's a four-sided figure. And put the earth from a particular place in the bins, and also the bins represented the way that it appeared on a map. So he would draw lines on a map, which then became the bins themselves, and then the earth was from that particular place was placed in it, and then it became a gallery piece, actually. And so we were showing his non-sites in the gallery. There, that one shot we're out in the cold and ice and snow. We were trying to get land. I guess it was for that piece. Yeah, for the airport piece. It was a little airport out in New Jersey that we stopped at and tried to dig into frozen ground to make this piece?
Well, we can't. There are two artists that we have to talk about before we wrap it up, and it would certainly be Mike Heiser.
Yeah. So
there's so many of Heiser's work that you were so kind of essential to. Double Negative, which we see here.
Well, this is Double Negative.
Yeah.
And I guess it's one of his earlier pieces, owned now by MoCA. I donated it to MoCA, the artist, and I donated. He had made a number of works before then. I was getting ready to do the Earthworks show, and this young man came in and had an album full of photographs of works out on the land. And I didn't know him at all, and I didn't know these works at all. So when he left, I called Walter DeMaria, who had sent him in, and I said, who is this anyway? And he said, well, if you mean, is he authentic? Yes, he is, and he's an original. And so coming from Walter, who had very definite ideas and was very demanding of just about everything, I realized this really was somebody who was working on the land and was doing earthworks before, as far as I knew at that moment, at any rate, before anybody. I still don't know, but there probably might be somebody else. Mm-hmm. One could.
And of course, there's the city complex began in 1972.
Yes.
Still an ongoing piece.
That piece is a mile and a half long at this point. And City Complex 1, the first part of it, I was involved in making sure it happened. I was paying for part of it, and certainly was out there to see what it was, which was quite amazing. But since then, he's built the piece called Just the City, or Just City, which you see in the lower picture. And there are very few photographs of that, but it's a continuation of City Complex 1. And as I say, running for a mile and a half. So I haven't seen it at this point, where it is now.
And Spiral Jetty, which...
And Spiral Jetty. What, today I open the New York Times and I see Spiral Jetty in about a 5-foot photograph, yeah. 5-inch photograph. Yeah. And that was such a nice feeling. Yeah. That here, a person that I knew is this, well, we were both in our early 30s, would come in and sit and chat with me, and we spent endless hours together talking. And here he is being in New York Times in an article that said this great
Spiral
artist.
Spiral Jetty is named an official state work of art by Utah.
Yes, you got it. Yeah.
And actually next to that we have the scene from the White House with where it says, Obama designates Nevada area surrounding Heiser City as a national monument, which is pretty wonderful to see this as the kind of protection of these works for the future.
Oh, it's wonderful. And I heard that Obama, before signing this piece of paper, said to Harry Reid, who had been out on the land, can you describe the piece to me? And Harry Reid said, no, I can't. I can't describe it. And yet it went through.
And fortunately it went through. Yeah. Well, I think this is a kind of a wonderful way. James, do you want to?
Well, I also wanted to point out that what we're seeing with these works, and there's also, of course, Charles Ross's Star Axis.
Mm. Yes, that of you course. Are oh my gosh.
Star Axis of Charles Ross.
Here we go. Yeah.
And of course, the first or the 35-pole lightning field of Walter de Maria.
Right.
That you are moving into being really a patron, and the gallery closes in 71, but your work continues in as a patron of these extraordinary things.
Exactly.
Yes.
And it continues today.
That's right. Thank you.
And I think it makes an astonishing kind of a trajectory of starting kind of in Westwood and moving kind of to supporting works that now the surrounds will be protected forever. And it's what an amazing legacy. So I want to really thank, I mean, we could go on for another hour, but I think this is like a fitting way to conclude. Mm-hmm. But I just want to say, Virginia, this has been an extraordinary honor and a pleasure to be able to chat with you here in Los Angeles and to have James as your kind of interlocutor. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie.